Your e-ticket ride into the world of the paranormal. Strap yourself in as we traverse the universe, exploring the unexplained. UFOs, ghosts, lost worlds, cryptozoology, as well as other dimensions. It's time to take back the night. Now, your electrifying hosts of Exploring the Bizarre, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
Well, happy Halloween, everybody. This is Tim Beckley talking to you from the Big Apple. And out in Indiana, we have our co-host, Tim Swartz. Are we going trick-or-treating, Tim?
Oh, sure, if you want to.
What are you getting dressed up as?
Well, our theme this year with my daughter, myself, and some family friends is the disco era. So we're dressing up as, you know, like party goers at discotheques from the 70s.
And you're going as John Travolta?
No, actually, I have got and how sad is this? I actually I got from Amazon a Halloween costume that looks like an old leisure suit. Uh-huh. And the sad thing is that it bears a remarkable resemblance to a leisure suit that I actually had when I was in high school at around that era. And of course, that was the, you know, I mean, you thought you were cool then. I mean, you know, you had the leisure suit and then those silky shirts that they used to have at the time. And now it's a Halloween costume. So, you know.
Well, you know, we have a place here. It's not really a Halloween. Halloween stores are very big in New York. They open up like you know, two or three weeks before Halloween, and mm-hmm. then close the day after. And there's one place here. It's Ricky's, and they have a place. They mainly sell like makeup and things along that line. And do you they have a place that just sells, like, I guess, costumes that they open for the holiday. And you can buy, like, an orange suit and a suit that has dollar bills all over it, you know, painted on and stuff like that. It's but they would sell it to you all year long. Halloween, but... Yeah,
well,
yeah.
Here in my town, they actually have a costume store that's open all year round. You know, mm-hmm. Though, I mean, naturally, it gets its best business during Halloween, but I'm actually going as a disco ball. I've made like a head out of a paper mache that I've covered it with little mirrors. So I'm
well, you know, you will have to take photos of that and post them on Facebook and on our show here on the website, because everybody will want to see that. Well, actually, now this weekend I am going as Mr. Creepo, and I am marrying my nephew Danny and his wife to be Corey in a Halloween wedding pagan type of ceremony in New Jersey. And this is my first wedding that I've actually performed, and I am a legal minister for the event. And I won't say what I'm going as at the moment, because I don't want to give it away, but it certainly should be fun. I mean, You know, I've always been into the concept of horror. You and I, Tim, have worked on horror films together. I mean, it's just The Curse of Ed Wood and Skin-Eating Jungle of Vampires and New Jersey Masquerade. I forget what the name of that was. Well, you know why? Because it's been released under several different titles.
That's right.
And indeed it has. But anyway, so I am officiating at a wedding this Saturday on Halloween. And of course, you know, I've kind of always been into the horror subject. And my grandfather on my father's side of the family actually saw behind the barn a headless horseman. Down in Kentucky, that's where my dad was from, and he would never talk about it though, because he was a pretty strict Baptist, and it's just something he, you know, he just never spoke of it because it kind of wasn't, you know, allowed. But he did, I guess, mention it maybe once or twice, and then refused to discuss the subject after that. But we figure now in the area where he lived. Had been a battle, you know, between the North and the South during the Civil War, and apparently one of the militiamen got his head blown off with a cannonball. That's how you explain the not for him, I would say. But,
No.
It's not something that you I guess discuss in polite circles. And then, you know, the house that I was born in or raised in. Was haunted. We had the poltergeist phenomena, lights going on and off, and I remember one time a piece of chinaware slid across the table and fell onto the floor, but it didn't break. Lights going on and off, doors opening and closing, the sound of a baby crying, footsteps in the snow, that kind of thing, you know. So I kind of grew up involved in all of this. I bought my first issue of Fate magazine, I think, when I was 10 years old. And when I started going to New York to work for Jim Moseley as a publisher, he was publisher of Saucer News, and he hired me as managing editor. A couple of years after that, I started probably what was one of the first metaphysical centers in the country, the New York School of Occult Arts and Sciences. And we had just about every well-known psychic and paranormal researcher and ghost hunter. Kind of like you started there, and you know, some of them went on to became very famous and well known. And in fact, we have an old friend of mine from those days with us tonight. One of our guests is Sean Robbins. Sean also lives here in New York, and she was one of the mediums, the psychics that the famed ghost hunter Hans Holzer worked with. And tonight we're actually going to be discussing, among other subjects, the Bell Witch, which was one of America's, America's first poltergeist case and ghost story.
Or at least recorded.
Yeah, indeed. Well, in fact, we have with us tonight John Kelly, who is the lead, I don't know if you would call him actor, because it is a reality show. This Wednesday on A&E, a new program premiered called Curse the Bell Witch. And John is the main character in the series. He's trying to remove the curse of the Bell Witch from his family so that it doesn't continue down to his son. So, Sean and John, are you with us?
I am absolutely with you.
And John, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. How's it going?
All right. Well, happy Halloween to all of you. Now, who wants to start out by telling us a little bit about the Bell Witch? Sean, I know you were involved in the case with Hans Holzer. He asked you to investigate it. So this goes back to what time period?
Gosh, we're going way, way back into, let's say, the late 1970s, if I'm correct. But before I get into it, not because it's Halloween and you're supposed to be scared, let me tell you, when you hear these stories tonight, you will be scared because ghosts do exist. that is something, the curse of the Bell Witch that John Selleck, I think, is very, very scared about. He has reason to be scared because it's very, very true. In fact, I'm going to take you back to when Hans Holzer put me in a trance to find out more about the Bell Witch. And as a psychic medium, this is very important, one can also do what's known as time travel. Now, time travel simply is the ability to see, you know, objects. I could be here right now in New York City, but I can see all the way, like, across the world. Not like Sarah Palin, you know, who saw whatever she saw. I absolutely can see, real things, you know, from my window, you know, and above, because I was trained by the CIA, our government, in the Stargate program, to spy on the Russians and to find hidden submarines, you know, out in the waters that at that time our, you know, radar couldn't pick up. So they use psychics, you know, like myself, to train and to develop their ESP and psychic abilities to the highest level possible. But now let me get you back to the Bell Witch. So Hans Holzer is someone I worked with for many, many years. He was my mentor, my teacher, and also he was my best friend, and he believed in me. And the other medium that he used was Ethel Myers, who's very well known and is mentioned in so many of his books, you know, along with me. Hans had a very deep interest about the Bell Witch. For whatever reason, it could have been at that time he was writing a book, or he felt that there was much more of a mystery connected to the story. You know, if one takes a look at John Selleck, one can understand his reservations and being scared that there is a curse on the family. Although I could say honestly, I don't believe in curses, based upon what I've seen and read and saw on TV for the first episode, he has every reason to be scared, not because it's Halloween, because there is the possibility there is a curse. But I can honestly say that when I was under a trance, what Hans would do, he would hypnotize me, and, you know, he would count to 10 and say, you know, Sean, I want you to look, you know, and go, you know, over to this, you know, area and tell me what you see, which was basically, you know, the Bell Witch area. So in the trance, I was able to pick up that Kate Bell was, now this is the incredible part, was raped by Katie Bates was raped by the slave Wilbur. She carried a child for 7 months, or about 7 months. The child died, you know, unexpectedly after, I think it was 7 months, this is what I saw. And her husband, Frederick, was so appalled, so angry, that the baby was just like thrown into the woods. It is my feeling that that baby could be related to one of the reasons that John Selleck feels that there's a curse on the family. Is it possible it's the baby? You know, that's put a curse on the family. It's anything is possible, you know, in the, you know, realm of ghostly phenomena. But that was my story then. It holds true today, that it is really, really something going on in that house. And whoever visits that house, they have felt the same things that, you know, people from the past have felt. They felt their energy being drained. They felt a coldness. They actually, Tim, you talked about, I'm going to call you Tim B, about plates moving in the house, in your own home when it was haunted. But in that particular house, it's more than just, you know, plates being moved. It's a curse. It's a cursed mm-hmm. house. What's
well,
your feeling?
You know, I want to bring John in at this point. John, I want to make sure, how are we pronouncing your last name?
It's Kellick.
Kellick. All right.
Oh,
good. All right.
Yeah.
Fine.
We got that right.
Very now, ethnically Irish.
Now, you are not particularly a ghost hunter as a profession. I know your background is in acting. And how are you related to the Bell family? And how did you get involved in this? Because you have worked in security, and you have a background in the military. You're kind of more, I see you more as a Rambo type than a fellow who's lost in the woods, being scared silly by some ancient curse.
Well, no, I would never consider myself a Rambo type. time in the military. I was a Navy corpsman, which is a medic for both the Navy and Marine Corps side. And later I went into law enforcement. I was actually a real cop, everything from patrol, narcotics, investigations, went all the way up to state police. Went back Army. I was assigned to a psychological operations unit that ended up being a protective service. I worked protective service for upper level dignitaries and generals. And the acting part is something I fell into afterwards. It's like, why not do it? I actually started as a military and weapons advisor for some films and TV shows, and they're like, well, got a good look. You do all this stuff. Why don't you do this in front of the camera instead of being the guy showing us? So the acting part, acting and writing, I've been doing that for a long time. But all that basically is something that just came about. We do approach this from more of a scientific investigative method as best we can. And other specialists or advisors, like we would do in a real investigation, are brought in to assist. And if you're the last part, if you don't have any type of fear, I don't actually want you around me a lot of times, because the people without some type of awareness or maybe concern is the ones, those people without that is usually the guys that get you killed. So you get fearless people. There's a difference between being fearless and stupid. I like to stay in the non-stupid part.
So how are you directly related to the Bell family?
This is my on my mother's side. Actually, my father's side's from the Massachusetts area, and my mother's side's the Bells. I'm related on the Bell side on my mom's side. So this is something I've been hearing since I've been 6 years old. Here's the curse. Here's the legend. And along with that is, valid historical stories within the family where that has been applied to. So
your family took this serious, though, right from as far back as you can remember.
Yeah, hi, here you go. This is your family heritage. Isn't this great? Yeah.
Can I ask John a question?
Sure, go ahead.
Well, of course, okay.
John, being that you're in law enforcement and being, you're in the Navy, I think I remember you saying that. I know you have a heightened, from what I'm hearing from your own voice, a heightened sense of awareness about things around you. And that, as a psychic, I could pick up like cadence or rhythms, in people's voices. And you have a very interesting cadence and rhythm, but also in your speaking voice, my gut instinct, because that's how I, live my life, to me, you are a psychic. So you've heard all these stories. Have you been in the house yourself? Did you feel anything if you did go in? Or what were your gut instincts when you first heard these stories? Was it, it's not true, it is true? I mean, you're investigating it now. I mean, how do you see this? Or how do you see it playing out, the end game?
Well, with anything, I'm more of a cynical person. I try to accept things that I can see in front of my face and what the facts are. And I think as this goes along, you'll see we have used the methods of investigation. Far as being a psychic, I could never claim to that at all. Ask my ex-wife on that one.
With something else you mentioned when you were talking, you said that you were a medic. Am I correct?
Uh-huh.
Okay. When you're on the field or, you know, wherever, you had to encounter people that were dying, correct?
A lot.
Okay. During that time, did they mention that they saw, you know, let's say a loved one trying to take them over to the other side? Very important that I'm asking this because it has to do, believe it or not, and can be a connection with the Bell Witch. But did they see anyone?
Well, as I said, I spent time at war, and I also spent time in a war zone as a private military contractor also. I don't know how I can say this very frankly, and the best way I can say this is the last people usually ask for is their mother.
Which is very interesting.
That's all I can...
Okay, we got a commercial break coming up here, and we will be back as soon as we hear the lightning and the thunder, and we will. Oh, here it comes! Oh no, that's the curse of the lightning bolt here. But we're going to take a short break, and we'll be back in a few minutes.
Exploring the bizarre. Now back to exploring the bizarre with two of the most electrifying researchers in the paranormal, your hosts, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
And we are back with exploring the bizarre. And I do encourage our listeners to call us, ask a question, send us a text. However you feel is the best way to communicate with us. We love your questions, and you know we love hearing from you. So
You could even send us some candy for Halloween. We'll take that.
Oh, I always encourage that.
I like Godiva chocolate.
Well, okay. Choice. Let's, Sean. Do you have any other questions that you wanted to finish up asking John before we went to our break here?
Well, the main thing is, the reason I asked John about when people were dying, you know, did they see the spirit of a loved one? Because there have been many documented cases of people, you know, right before, you know, they passed on, they saw, you know, their mother, their father, relatives, including my own mom, who felt she was in bed with my father, who passed on, you know, 6 years earlier. If that's the case, and that is true, that, you know, people from the other side can, you know, comfort, you know, the dying and take, you know, and, you know, cross over to the Rainbow Bridge, you know, take them over, it means that the spirit doesn't die. And if the spirit doesn't die, you know, some people die violently. Those are the ones that linger. And I'm concerned in that house, in the Bell, you know, which house, that there is something going on in that house. And the only way to remove the curse, and it's quite possible, I have a suspicion on an intuitive level, that if they brought in cameras to investigate, or even, you know, one of the new technology, I think it's something to do with tapes, they will capture voices. And they will possibly capture an image. There's no doubt they're going to capture an image.
Well, you know, we don't know exactly what John is up to because.
Oh, okay.
Okay, we haven't. Now the series is already recorded. Correct, John. I mean, it's in the can, as they say, right?
Yeah, I can tell you there's been some interest. I can't really go directly into it, but I can tell you there was some interesting things that happened on. You know, and back on the battle side, you know, I'll have to be honest on that. When I was more focused on working on the person than anything else, you know, trying to save their life more than anything else around it, and it's chaotic in those circumstances. But yeah, I mean, I've heard of things to that nature. Seeing somebody that they, you know, relatives or whatever coming for them. I mean, not personally, but, you know, I've heard of it from other people.
What makes you think, Ed, that violence didn't take place in that house going back all the way back in time? That has to be a reason for the haunting. There's no doubt in my mind.
Well, one of the things is right now, and as you can see from the first episode, that it's basically where the house stood is basically a tree, a stone and a soybean field, and the leftover house is by the Bell School.
Is that the wood house that I saw on TV? The wood structure.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's that. Yeah, that was moved over there and preserved, kind of more or less like a museum piece. But they've from what I've heard, there has been some strange things go on there as well. So,
well, let me say this much: I'm well versed in remote viewing and psychometry. And psychometry, when I used to work on murder cases with the police, this is going back to the earlier part of my career. I used to hold an object that belonged to, you know, the deceased person. And they're able to pick up things, you know, and see things. But a lot of it has to do with imagination. But what I'm trying to say is that wood is a very, very good conductor of one's feeling and energy. Because, you know, if you look back today, you know, the 1990s, 2000, you know, 2010, most of the structures that are built are made out of, like, you know, now, what is it, stone or brick. Most hauntings were always, you know, in places that had like a wood structure. Wood absorbs energy. There's no doubt in my mind, you know, they say if these walls could talk, that, you know, that is very true. Those walls can talk because it's made out of wood. So I saw the first episode, fell in love with it. It was done phenomenally. And I just urge anyone tonight who's listening, you've got to tune into this. It's mind-boggling.
I appreciate that, man, because I'll tell you what, there's a lot of good people that worked on that, and they tried to get a great visual telling of it as well.
How many episodes are there?
There's five. You guys got to see number one. There's four more that's going to be every Monday night at 10 Eastern, 9 Central, and 7 Pacific. So,
well,
tune
you know,
the dials
to the,
at
to,
9.
Yeah, to this day, the Bell Witch is probably America's, outside of maybe the Amityville Horror, is probably America's most famous. I would call it. People refer to it as a ghost, but it's really a poltergeist. In fact, we have our own version of the story. It's called the Bell Witch Project, which we actually just published a couple of months ago, not realizing that there was going to be a TV series based on the story. So it's a kind of a perfect tie-in. And of course, being this the time of the year for Halloween and jack-o'-lanterns and the things that go bump in the night, it's a perfect time for this to you know, appear on television. I'm sure you had millions of viewers the other night for this, and a lot of them will hang on for the, you know, the rest of the series. Now, Sean, you've been considered to be one of the top 10 psychics in America. In fact, your predictions were always used in the Inquirer in their New Year's edition. Didn't you also weren't you also a spy?
Yes, in the 1970s, there was a group called, if I remember correctly, the Institute of Parapsychological Research that was actually funded by the CIA. the CIA was very curious to see if psychic, you know, if your psychic abilities, you know, could be enhanced. So there were three. I was one of the three original psychics in the program. There was a Malcolm Balfour from England, and Uri Geller, believe it or not, was one of the people involved in the project, and myself. What they would do, and it's fascinating because to this day I can't go to discos, they want to see if they could change your brain waves by flashing the strobe lights. You know, remember, this is the late 1970s. We didn't know as much, but they were curious to see, you know, well, that was just one way to see, could they change someone's brain waves? But could we actually move a compass? So the three of us, with combined energy, but we're not talking about something so tremendous like the compass, you know, totally turned around, but we used our mental energy to see if we could move the compass, and we did, but just such a slight amount that you could say, oh, it's just, you know, it just happened. But the people involved, Dr. Krippner, actually believed that that compass moved. We did it about three times, but you can't always do it. Then they would put you in a soundproof, lightproof room, keep you there for 12 hours. The reason being, you know, they wanted to disorient you to see if someone, and they had someone from the other side, you know, another booth, could send you photographs, and could you pick up what someone is sending you? The answer to that was yes. Then they had the overnight, you know, sleepovers, as I called them, but they would put you in a room, monitored, you know, all kinds of machinery, and as soon as you entered the deepest state of sleep, they would project images at you. And when, you know, then when they felt that, you know, that part was successful, the images went through based on the brain waves, they would wake you up. And you would then say, you know, I had a dream and I saw this circle with these bright orange colors and, you know, there was the devil, you know, supposedly in one of them and other, you know, figures. It turns out that you can, and they're actually doing it today in experiments and saying that it does work. You can influence someone's thoughts just by the power of the mind. So it's still going on, I think, the Stargate program. There are many new people in it. But the original part was basically very, you know, crude, you know, with the machinery and such. And then, you know, later on, you know, they had naval intelligence. And what they were trying to ascertain, because we didn't have what we have today with radar, so they were trying to locate Russian ships and submarines. So as a psychic, they showed us maps. And we were to pinpoint, you know, with like a thumbtack, where we saw, you know, the ships. And I would say to you that we were about, and this is more than 50%, 80% correct, because each psychic never knew what the other one, you know, was going to put these thumbtacks, because it was done individually. And we all came out the same. So there is something about mind over matter. It's being proven today, you know, they're now saying that robots can feel or they can think. Even though it's just robotic, you know, if we're giving emotion to a innate object, so why not the human mind? Why can't we use that same energy? And, you know, that's why when it comes to curses, why I believe, you know, when someone says, you know, I'm cursed or, you know, I'm going to curse you, you're changing someone's thought process and things become embedded. Now, I'm both, by the way, a skeptic and a believer. I'm just like somewhat like John. You know, I have to see it to believe it. But I kind of believe that if you honestly believe that you are cursed, is it a thought process that brings on, let's say, a traumatic, you know, let's say death because you believed in the curse? Or was the curse really real and that's what happened to you? So there's two ways of looking at it. And my instinct says that it's thought process. So I think there's hope for you, John, and your son. But that's my feeling.
Well, you know, with the combination of everything that's gone on in the family, there was things that went on prior to embarking on this that, you know, you hear this all your life, okay, to start with. But then you have some incidences that happen that say, you know, why not? Why should I take the chance? Why not look in? I do private and corporate investigations too, since I left law enforcement years ago, but to go overseas, but I come back and, you know, I work investigations, and I'm the person in the family with the investigative skills. So why not apply them to going after this, especially if you had something that could affect your children, could affect someone else in your family, why wouldn't you?
That is true. You that would. I would do the same thing.
Well, John, I've been reading about the Bell Witch ever since I probably was old enough to pick up my first scary book. And one of the things that I remember is that Kate allegedly said before she disappeared for the first time that, you know, she was going to, you know, come back at a later date. Now, did anybody in your family ever tell you, you know, was there any stories that she did return that, you know, maybe didn't get out to, you know, to the public? You know, kind of kept it a family secret almost.
Well, I believe in that. There was another book that was published, I can't recall right at the moment, that basically come back and she foretold, like, it was before the Civil War, foretold that and different other things. And I've heard stories within the family that there was some interesting situations that went on that they didn't say much more after that, because how's the best way to put it?
Well, Tim, you're going to say something. Hello.
No, go ahead.
Yeah,
go
they
ahead.
Told us, you know, they told the base of the story and then some of the things they left out along the way. Like, you know, I'd asked more about it when I was a kid, and, you know, I got that knowing look and, like, you know, let's not talk about that. Let's not talk about that.
Well, they were too frightened to talk about that, or if they felt if they talked about that, They would give life to the story, which is make it more alive. Or some people can only take a certain amount of information and then they shut down because it becomes too overwhelming for them emotionally. But I'm curious, was there ever talk of, let's say, anyone born out of wedlock, or you know things going on you know with other people, you know, I guess having affairs would be the right word. Well, I don't know what they called it back then.
Well, I mean, you know, back in the 1800s, of course, it was almost unheard of not to be, definitely taboo to be, you know, a single mother. Now, you look at other cases, like with Drury Bell, the guy lived the rest of his life as a recluse, never had children. That was almost basically your main job, you know, have a farm, have a kid, you know, bring in the next generation. And he basically stayed away from that. I've heard different variations of it. One of it that there was a child born out of wedlock, and it may have been between the Bells and the Bats. I mean, it could have been someone else. I really didn't get a full story on that, but they're, you know, just rumors.
That is John, yeah. Do you know anything about the stories that General Andrew Jackson was actually involved in this and investigated the case and got so scared that he got up and left early in the morning?
Well, yeah, you heard both sides of it. I've heard on one side that he, you know, he was, of course, he, you know, he was connected to John Bell Jr., to the Bell Sons, because they were fighting, you know, Tennessee Volunteers, and, you know, they fought with him. And, you know, he was a prominent man. John Bell was a prominent man in that area. I mean, he wasn't broke at all. And Yeah, I've heard the stories where he came to the cabin. I believe there's a marker, or there is, when I was up in Adams or close to there, there's a marker or a story there where he was riding in the carriage and it stopped him, and he politely asked him to go, politely asked the entity. And that's what I've come to more call this, more than a ghost or a spirit or a witch, is an entity. And as you go along in the story and find out more about this, and I can't give too much away with this, but I think there's more to this than what has been reported for a long time. And I hope that with this show, we've done a very comprehensive investigation into it, not just on the paranormal side, but also as factually as we can get, and looking at all the different sides and the different stories. If I was going to work in a criminal investigation, if I was doing a criminal investigation, I would look at all sides of the stories and gather evidence and then come up with a conclusion instead of, well, you come up with theories, you come up with hunches, you know, it's going to lead to a conclusion one way or another.
I do have something to suggest, and this is coming again from my psychic side. There's no doubt in my mind, as you were talking, John, I saw a woman, darkish hair, you know, looked dark, but it could be dirty, you know, like a dirty blonde or dark. Someone, you know, today we call it dementia, but my instinct says there was a woman in her 40s to 60s, and which is, I know, a young age, but I don't know if you would call it schizophrenia today, you know, at that time, but she was mad. It would be the better way to describe her. But there, it was someone in your family. It was a woman that was totally off the wall. Her energy, I think, and you may not have, you know, you may be doing the second series, for all I know, after this series, when you uncover it. But that's my gut instinct, that part of that haunting has to do with the woman who absolutely went mad. Now, I don't know if she went mad because of the goings-on or was something, you know, just, you know, genetic, you know, but whatever it is, it, absolutely, I see this woman, and I see her now. There's no doubt in my mind that someone was mad at that time.
Well, I'll have to tell you, we all have one of those people in our family somewhere along the line.
Not mine.
I'm the one in my family.
Yeah, you know, if you look around in your family and you don't have the crazy person in your family, no offense to people, you're that person.
See, now John is scaring us all for Halloween. We were going along so nicely. Now we're all going to look back into our own family history to find the bad man or woman.
Hey, my pumpkin just melted over here. I don't know what I'm going to do. My pumpkin just blew up just as you said that, Sean.
Well, yeah, it's going to turn into pumpkin latte from now on. Everything's pumpkin at this season. But yeah, no, with all that, there's been different ways that with Andrew Jackson's side, they said that the witch or the entity manifested itself in different ways, as a dog, as some type of hound, also in a mist, in a smoke, in a disembodied voice, and all that put together, you know, I wouldn't necessarily say that it was just a poltergeist. My opinion.
Well, there seems to be an awful lot of energy involved in this case for it just to be, like you said, like a poltergeist or a human spirit or something like that. Yeah.
And you know, and it's gone on for such an incredible a long period of time, and also seems to move about to some degree, wouldn't you say, John? Because you have, like you say, the manifestations in the house or the structure that was moved, and also people who claim that they've witnessed phenomena that takes place in the what they call the Bellwitch Cave, which really didn't have anything originally to do with the manifestation.
Yeah, that's Adams is a nice town, but it is a little spooky, I have to tell you. It seems along the stories and what I've been told over time that it not only has attached itself to a certain area, but also to certain members in the family and has followed different lines of the family, because Betsy went down to, and I can never pronounce this name, Yallabusha, Mississippi, which is close to, I think Ole Miss or the other one, Mississippi State College, in northern Mississippi, and lived the rest of her life there. And she had, the Bell side, the Bell family split like a lot of families off into different trees along the way. And each, I think a lot of them have their own stories with what happened. I've even read recently that there was a 1912 or 1915 account of possibly the Bell Witch being a manifestation of the Bell Witch being in northern Alabama.
Well, we're running out of time. The witch is going to come get us if we don't move ourselves out of here. So I want to thank the two of you, Sean and John, for being with us tonight. And quickly, Sean, what are you working on now? What are you manifesting out there now?
Well, I have my new book is out, Wiccipedia, Wiccapeda, going now into its fourth printing. But most important, I just want to wish John all the best on his show, because I love it and I give it 10 thumbs up.
Oh,
thank you.
Exploring the bizarre. Your e-ticket ride into the world of the paranormal. Strap yourself in as we traverse the universe, exploring the unexplained. UFOs, ghosts, lost worlds, cryptozoology, as well as other dimensions. It's time to take back the night. Now, your electrifying hosts of Exploring the Bizarre, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
Here we are at the second hour of Exploring the Bizarre. Tonight we're talking about Halloween, ghosties and ghoulies and long-legged boolies and things that go, in the night. Is that right, Tim?
I believe so. Absolutely. This is the week of where the spirit world becomes the closest to the physical world. Isn't that right, Alan?
Yes, and in fact, that whole concept of as you move into All Hallows Eve, as it is known in, well, basically Catholic lore, although American Halloween is unique in all the world. I mean, it's festive, and in most places it's rather gloomy Day of the Dead type stuff, but it is part of the primal world culture. Wherever you go in the world, there is somewhere around, allowing for differing calendars, somewhere between the 26th of October and the 4th of November, which happens to be the birthday of myself. Nevertheless, it's there. And it's the notion that the world of the dead and the world of the living come into contact, into close contact with one another, not through mediums, not through psychics, not through Ouija boards, but accessible to all who look there. Now, with kids running around the street looking for candy and wearing candy man masks, It's probably somewhat tainted here. But if you go down to Old Mexico or spend New Year's Eve in New Year's Eve, well, yeah, it is actually in some cultures. You spend Halloween in New Orleans in the St. Louis Cemetery number 3, where Marie Laveau is buried. You can get very close to that universe just by being attuned to it. I think that it's probably one of the most ancient beliefs in the world. It dates from shamanic lore, which is worldwide, and I mean, it probably dates from the beginning of Homo sapiens. So it's a universal concept that, as usual in America, we've turned into a fun cavorting things. So even the
commercial,
pumpkin,
very, very, very commercial. Probably outside of Christmas, the most commercial. I use holiday in quotes, but it's maybe you don't get off of work, but even if you don't, most people do celebrate Halloween here, except for a few maybe small religious groups who see it as totally demonic. You know, I should point out before we go any further that Alan and I are old cohorts. We have known each other for 50 years. That 50. Is, now, that's the day.
I'm not
day
even 50 years old. What are you talking about, Mr. Beckley? Mr. Allen is only 35.
Oh, yes. We met when we were in our teens. Alan and I both ran what was known as teen UFO organizations, and we were among the early organizers of the National UFO Conference, or the Congress of Scientific Ufology, I think it was called in those days. And Alan and I hadn't seen each other for a long, long time until we met in Cleveland, Ohio, at a reunion of the group. Now, Alan has traveled all over the world seeking out the truth and information on the paranormal and on ghosts and on all sorts of weird phenomena. He is also author of many different titles and different books that you can find at Amazon.com, like Secret Ciphers of the Ufonauts. And what is the other one, The Secret Rites of Memphis?
The Complete Rite of Memphis revised edition is the one I'd recommend. It's not expensive, and basically, if you want to touch other worlds, that's a good approach to it. And I also get paid royalties on that one, unlike most of the others that the publishers have stolen the royalties long since.
And of course, now Alan also contributed to our book,
Angel Spells.
Angel Spells, and had quite a bit of excitement stirred up back, I guess about, 6 or 7 months ago. Alan was on the program Ground Zero, hosted by Clyde Lewis out of Oregon. And Alan did I don't know if you would call it a ritual, it was an invocation, right? With one of the archangels, and it happened to be the Archangel of the Wind. Well, now, do you not know that the roof of the building where Ground Zero is broadcast from was taken off totally by a storm that struck the very next day? Now, at first I thought, well, Clyde is maybe telling us a little bit of a story, but boy, I Googled it, and sure enough, there was on YouTube a news report of exactly what had happened, you know, from the 6 o'clock news. So we're not fooling around here. Alan has many, many powers.
And, yes, and causing a storm that caused a couple of people to die, probably the best way to describe what I was doing is, if I had wanted to do something negative on the air, I would have invoked Barzabal, who was the negative storm being. And what I did was ameliorate a storm that was destined to do something that doesn't happen very often in the Northwest, even though there's no truth to this global warming stuff, right? Right, 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 right.
That's right.
The Donald says so, and he must know. So, be that as it may, I could see that there was a storm coming, and I ameliorated it by reciting an archangelic invocation. And thus, instead of essentially a tornado in a place that, you know, has no preparation for tornadoes at all, it was a serious but lesser storm. And had I, you know, been fully aware that that was imminent, I probably could have done a lot more on that. It's just as easy to ameliorate bad weather as it is to conjure up bad weather. And conjuring up good weather is the trickiest part. Okay, that stopped them all there. Okay, now I will channel Mark Prophet, who said, "Don't listen to my wife; she goes on and on." Okay, never mind. You were asking. Come on, Tim. One of you, Tims, which is Mitt spelled backwards, which is a Romney, which is a Mormon, which is another story entirely. But getting back to what was this an introduction or what?
Sure, how did you get the title bishop? Bishop, how did you get the title bishop, Alan?
Well, I was involved in the esoteric community. Now, I must do the disclaimer that often happens. There are a lot of overlapping titles between high church religion and Masonic and crypto-Masonic organizations. And I'm more, you can see that particular title is more, in my case, of a Masonic sort of background rather than my religion. My religion has been the same my whole life. I have the dullest of all religions. I'm a Reformed Jew, was born into that, live in that, and will probably be buried in that, hopefully after I'm dead. But, you know, so, but it's a Masonic title that came from one of the principal heads of the Ancient and Primitive Rite of Memphis and Mitzrayim, which is what the book we were referring to, The Complete Rite of Memphis, is about. Michael Berdio, in 1986, convened the synod of his particular group, and they elected me bishop, and I was later consecrated by the Grand Caliph of the U.S. OTO and other organizations that I'm no longer a part of, but you can't take bishop back from anybody because once a bishop, always a bishop. That's not me. That's St. Augustine. And I use it as a power source, an egregore of, you know, historical, going back to the ancient Roman and Egyptian state religions, which were headed by pontiffs. And the supreme pontiff, the Pontifex Maximus of the Roman state religion, was, after the time of Julius Caesar, for about 300 years, the same office. And then there was a lot of pressure to hand that over to the then reigning pope, and that was done. But the title bishop precedes the title priest, actually, in Roman religion. It's it means bridge, and I sort of see myself as a bridge between worlds.
Okay. Well, Alan, since Halloween is coming up here, why don't you tell us a little bit about your ghost experiences at the graveyard of Christ Church in Georgia? I think that's something that our audience would be interested in hearing.
Okay, I'll tell the story. First of all, there is a sort of one of the places in my home state, Georgia, that is saturated with ghost stories, is a little island off the Georgia coast called St. Simon's Island. It was among the, it has some important historical roots. It's where the British defeated the Spanish in the early 1700s, the Spanish coming north from the Castillo de San Marcos, which is haunted as well in Florida. And the English under General Oglethorpe turned them back so that this country would remain an English-speaking country until recently. And it also was the place where the Wesley brothers came to preach for the Anglican Church. The church is still there. Well, it's a second incarnation of the church, but it dates from the 1800s. And They came there as Anglican priests, and when they left, their encounter with the strange fires of Georgia, which actually is the name of a locally well-known book on the subject, they went back to England and formed the Methodist Church, and you will see the relic of that in the southern United States is that every small town in the South, whatever else it has, it certainly has a Baptist church and a Methodist church, not necessarily anything else, but that's a direct result of encounter on St. Simon's Island. Anyway, the church where the Wesley brothers encountered the grand what's-it that led them to follow a different path from the traditional Anglican way of looking at the universe was remained a church and remains so to this day. It's still technically an Episcopalian or Anglican church. In the 1870s, the minister there had just married, and as happened not infrequently in those days, particularly in swampy areas like that, his wife took sick and died. Shortly thereafter, there's a graveyard directly next to the church, which is, you know, very common, especially in older churches. And this one dates back to the early Georgia colony in the 1700s. People began to see a ghostly figure, which they attributed to this woman, the wife of the priest of the church at that time. And those stories came forward into my own time, which as at the same time I was getting interested in UFOs and paranormal research and other things, I was also interested in ghost lore. And one of the first things that showed up was there were cases, including modern cases, of people who went to that cemetery and saw a ghostly presence. So to jump to the meat of the story, I talked Jim Mosley, may he rest in peace, into going down there with me, even though he called himself a psychic negative. That is, whenever he was around, nothing ghostly would happen. He, I think, probably hoped that it would, but he thought of himself as a psychic negative. And a friend of ours from the local UFO group here in Atlanta went with us. And after an unfortunate encounter with the local police, where they told us a story about a Bible salesman who'd been there last year and gone into the cemetery and got himself shot, which Jim acted very guilty about, and I thought, we're dead men here. This is clearly a warning, and Jim doesn't get it. He's a New Yorker. He doesn't get what this is all about. I, on the other hand, am from a small town in Georgia, and when the sheriff tells you that kind of anecdote, it's a polite way of saying, get out of town by sunset, boy.
Of course, today in a lot of places, they shoot and don't tell you the story.
Yeah, well, that he was one of the liberals. He gave you a warning before he shot. That's not like today. You get out of the car and you say, "I'm here to look at the ghost on the in the cemetery." You, well, you're likely to at least wind up being questioned extensively, and as they say in Masonry, with the third degree. But we proceeded on to a couple of ghostly sites with the kind of equipment that you would have in the 1967-68 period. That was the period where we did a lot of looking into cases down here. In fact, Tim was joined us on one of the others.
We went to Brown Mountain.
Yeah, and we saw I saw the lights. I don't know if you saw.
I've seen the lights, the party lights, the red and blue and green.
Yes, well, we had a perfect team of investigators. There was Betty Mosley and Jim and me, the most
reliable. And we sang Christmas carols, or they sang Christmas carols on the way to the moon, or something like that. Right?
Yeah, well, because that was the same night that the first lunar orbiter with men aboard successfully transited the moon. And when we got back from the mountain seeing the lights, they were reading from the Bible on TV. And you were talking to your mom on the phone, and I looked at the TV and I thought, oh, God, something's gone wrong with their mission. They're reading the Bible. But it was Christmas Eve, and being Jewish, that didn't immediately register that they were reading Genesis to dramatically keep NASA in good with skeptical, faithful, good old boys down here in the Bible Belt. But in any case, hey, so
back to the ghost in the cemetery.
So after we go to Bloody Marsh and Ebo Landing, we go to that church, and it's past sunset, and there's it's very dark, and there are no lights whatsoever, except in the church side window, which was a Wednesday night, so it told me they probably were having choir practice. But anyway, we had gone and spoken to the priest of the church. He was very hostile to us. He said, well, you can go and take a look, but that's all baloney. So we went out and we walked around for a while, and Mosley explained to us a couple of the interesting points about grave robbing, because he said, this is definitely a cemetery because you can feel that give in the earth that after it has been dug up. And so that was, it was perfect, you know, moss-strewn oaks. And in fact, they're called the Wesley Oaks because they used to preach under those trees. And old graves and brand new fresh ones. And as long as I stayed with Psychic Negative Jim Mosley, nothing happened. And
you were safe.
Well, I didn't want to be safe. You see, I'm not afraid of these things. I would be afraid if there were none. I'm much more interested in seeing these manifestations because they kind of confirm, that there is otherness out there. So anyway, I decided, well, maybe Jim is a psychic negative. I love the man, but, you know, he is so skeptical in his own way that he may just turn the spirit sour. So with my little Yashica J7 35 millimeter camera, I wandered off away from him and over towards the side of the church. And I suddenly get, it would be unfair to call it a verbal message, but I got a message, take a picture now. It was nothing to take a picture of. I just looked at the side of the church and pressed the button on the camera, which was a 1 second exposure. And I knew that that was a manifestation that when I, it was like photography, really. When I got it developed, it would show something paranormal. And when my film came back from being developed, they had not developed that particular image. So I had a brief discussion with my mom on the subject, and she said, well, we'll take it back and we'll see. And they developed it, and it was a decomposing woman hovering about 7 or 8 feet off the ground within the cemetery. I happened to know, even at this early date, having been in ufology at that point for 7 years, that Eastman Kodak in Rochester, New York, had a person who was on the payroll whose sole job was to explain anomalies in photos. So I sent the negative to Jim Mosley, who was then living in Fort Lee, New Jersey, the birthplace of the American film industry, actually. Obscure point. And he forwarded it on to the Kodak person who specialized in that. And they could not figure it out. So I thought, well, I got a real one here. But for years, you know, that was the only investigation that could be done, because this is like, you know, pre-computer sort of access or anything. Basically, this was the only guy other than military who could analyze the photo and see what it was that I was seeing in the photo. I showed it to a lot of people, and most people saw exactly what I did, a decomposing female figure with a big ruffled late 19th century collar. in more recent years, and I'm going to be a little bit vague about this, I'll just say that I had a social contact unrelated to politics in any way in the KGB in Moscow. And he was interested in, as a lot of people in the Soviet Union were, interested in paranormal research. There was a huge amount of, it's like without the official government line of materialism, you had all kinds of interests peeking around the corner through paranormal research. So he was very interested in that, and as far as I know, still is, although not in the KGB anymore. But anyway, he moonlighted into the KGB photo analysis lab. He was their photo analyst guy over there, comparable to the Kodak guy here, and made use of the KGB's considerable, I hear music.
Yeah, Alan, we're going to have to freeze that thought for just a few minutes here as we go to our break.
What,
so
they take me away?
Yeah.
That's the spirits prancing naked around the tombstones.
That's Amen. Right. So we'll come back and we'll finish the story about the KGB analysis of your photograph. So I'm Tim Swartz with Alan Greenfield and, of course, Tim Beckley. You're listening to Exploring the Bizarre.
Now back to Exploring the Bizarre with two of the most electrifying researchers in the paranormal, your hosts, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
Well, you know, that kind of intro reminds me, Alan, of the Mystic Barber. Remember, he used to walk around with antenna on his head.
And I'm afraid. Synchronicity. I was thinking about Andy Sinatra today and his appearance on the Johnny Carson Tonight Show in full regalia. I don't think about him on a daily basis, you know, not even a yearly basis. And
well, you know,
bring him up. Yes, I mean, that's
synchronicity is just beyond the pale with me. You know, I didn't even mention with the previous guest that we had on, who is the fellow who is the lead a character in Curse the Bell Witch on the A&E network that premiered this week. But when I heard about the show, I said, geez, we got to get somebody on from the program, because I've published a book, The Bell Witch Project, you know, on this very subject, on this America's earliest haunting and ghostly phenomenon. So I went to Facebook, and I typed in John's name, and I saw that we had one mutual friend. And that mutual friend, his last name was Bell. And I said, well, this must be a descendant of the Bell family. So I sent a message to this fellow whose last name was Bell. And I said, well, why don't you come on the program with John, and we can talk about it. And you can tell us about what, you know, like what you know about the, you know, your family tree and all. And he texts me back and he said, I've never heard of the Bell Witch. So our one mutual friend, his last name is Bell, but it has nothing to do with the Bell Witch. That, to me, is spooky. And Alan, you know, I could go on for hours about synchronicities. One question before we get back to the Christchurch episode here. What is the history? We talk about the jack-o'-lantern. I have one under my hand here and a bag of candy in the other. Do you know anything about the history of the jack-o'-lantern and why we give away candy to kids?
Well, the candy part, I don't know. It's probably because trick-or-treat preceded that. And the fact is that people used to, even in my day as a kid, oh, this is a confession on top of a confession. First, I'm talking to KGB, and now I'm talking about being a vandal as a child. But, you know, the laws in Georgia, youth cases are sealed. But we used to, if they didn't give us something, money or candy or something, it used to be money, we would do terrible things to people's houses and mailboxes especially, even though fireworks were only legal for agricultural purposes. That was just standard practice among kids in the South back in the day. Now that would be, you know, 2 years to life, depending on who catches you. Or they, you know, if you happen to be of the wrong color, they simply shoot you on the spot. So that sort of practice is gone. However, the whole thing with jack-o'-lanterns goes back to the will-o'-the-wisp phenomenon, which is a genuine, although natural, phenomenon. It's equivalent to swamp gas. It's in swampy places you see these lights, and the legend of the jack-o'-lantern was the lights would lure you into the swamp and drown you, that they were malevolent spirits, which I've actually in the hoodoo world, which actually I grew up up to the age of 10 around hoodoo, original hoodoo practices in the South. There's a lot of you know, people who've read books and are doing it now, but this was like the real McCoy back in the day in small towns on the Savannah River. And I would hear stories of the same sort, but the jack-o'-lantern as we think of it, which is a pumpkin, has to be of American origin, because the pumpkin, like the tomato, is native to the Americas, therefore cannot be part of European tradition, unless you think the Vikings came over, took a pumpkin back to Europe and started Halloween. I mean, that's, which is, it's a much older thing than even the Vikings. So it's mostly an American custom. In Mexico, they use skulls, sometimes made out of candy. What is it called? Marzipan? It's kind of a hard candy. Mm-hmm. And it's a basically worship of the ancestors, worship of the dead, because the dead are close to the living on this particular day. But here, it's become hollowing out pumpkins. And I guess that custom has, just as tomatoes have become more associated with Italy than with America, I think that probably pumpkins are grown in other places and maybe used for Halloween purposes. But it's a development of the last century or so. Halloween, just in my lifetime, young as I am, has gone from being a, you know, very, very small, minor holiday to being almost as big as Christmas in terms of...
Almost, yep.
And it's, you know, much more comfortable for me than Christmas. So I enjoy it, and I always play Dracula, the 1931 version, with the new score by Philip Glass. And then I played the Spanish version, which was filmed during the day. Bela Lugosi and his group of Hungarian troubadours did their thing. And then at night, because they didn't have good dubbing in the early 1930s, they hardly had a soundtrack, the Spanish cast came on and they tried to top the American cast. So I play both versions every Halloween while the kids come to the door and I give them their lollipops or whatever I give them. And then they go off and see flowers and trees and stuff.
Well, if I were in your neighborhood, I would come and get my candy and a handout for money as well. But this Halloween, I am marrying my nephew Danny and his wife-to-be, Corey. And we decided, or he decided actually, and his wife, to have the ceremony. I'm actually doing the marriage ceremony, Alan. I've got my license, and I'm going in there as Mr. Creepo, and I'm going to unite them in matrimony. And I, you know, the reason that I got so involved in this is because I realized that even though there will be members of the family there, there are a lot of members of the family who have passed on. And since it is the time when the spirit world becomes the closest to the physical world, there may be members of the family who have passed over who could actually join us in our celebration.
Yeah, I, as in my capacity as bishop, I have performed any number of marriage ceremonies, but it's in Georgia, there are so many weird religions that there are almost no requirements. You know,
there is very little, yes.
Well, in New York City, there is a local registry that you have to register.
Well, this is in New Jersey, but yeah, it's taken care of. But you're right. There is hardly any requirement except to pay whatever you have to pay and sign the paper. That's pretty much what it is. But you know, we kind of lost our
KGB.
Back to the ghost in the was the ghost in the window? It seems to me that I remember.
No, it was not in the window, and that's very telling, because the only natural source of light we didn't even have flashlights. I don't know what Mosley and the other guy were doing wandering around the cemetery at that point, probably something illegal, but that's neither here nor there. I was standing facing the side of the church from the side of the church that the cemetery was on. So I was in the cemetery looking at the illuminated window at the back of the church to my right. In the photo, you can see the window.
Well, I remember the window was lit up.
Yes. To the left and at a different height and much closer to the camera at about guesstimating 7 or 8 feet. So higher than a human being standing would be, even if they were a basketball player, which is unlikely of a woman in the 19th century. Probably impossible now that I think about it, was the ghost. And the KGB was even more, the KGB officer whose assignment had been, photo analysis and using all of the technical equipment that they had by night, not officially. This is in the late days of the Soviet Union, when Gorbachev was in office, so there was Glasnost was around. So it wasn't like some terrible crime that he was committing by, using the equipment. I mean, he might have lost his job or something if he'd been found, but he wouldn't have been shot in the basement of the Lubyanka prison for looking at a ghost photo. But his conclusion was that this is an authentic picture of an anomalous phenomena that is not explainable in any kind of conventional photographic terms whatsoever. So I would say my ghost has the bill of authenticity from Eastman Kodak and from the former KGB. So there we go.
That's quite a distinction there now, isn't it?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I having gone through so many UFO photos that were tossed in the air or were on the end of a fishing pole when Barker showed up here to show it and say, hey, there's a fishing line hanging from the thing. And it's he would say. Although, Gray gets a bad rap. I mean, he did. I was reading some stuff today in Nick Redfern's new book about sort of the follow-up on the Men in Black. And people are buying into that article that some guy from the Skeptic magazine, who was one of Barker's young friends.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, yes.
Yeah, who basically said everything is a...
Sherman, I believe.
Yeah, well, that's his real name.
Shermer?
Yes.
Different, yeah.
Mr. Peabody and Sherman, that's who we're talking about. But the point is, his word is taken as gospel. But I knew Gray very well. He was genuinely my friend enough to know what the likely relationship there was. And frankly, I think Gray is credited with far more hoaxing than he actually did. He was careful. He and Jim would get together and they'd get stoned and drunk and do all kinds of things on the telephone and write the occasional screwy letter to a contactee or whatever, because they really hated some of the George Adamski circle of anti-Semitic contactees, and that's where the R.E. Straith letter came from, but which was a notorious fake that they later got scared that they were going to be taken into custody, which in that era was very possible. The equivalent of Gitmo awaited them, but they Gray buried pieces of the typewriter all over West Virginia, and but most of the stuff that is attributed to Gray pulling pranks are not Gray Barker pranks. One, I was involved with on the receiving end of one of them, and there's that's the Man in Black photo. Anyway, the ghost photo is for real, And it reminds me of how hard it is to convince skeptics. Not that, you know, convincing skeptics is important to me. I mean, my attitude is, I really want to find out what this stuff is all about. And I think that I'm a lot closer than most people that are involved in it. But there's, you know, there's such a vast amount of complexity to these subjects that saying yes or no, or I believe this, or I disbelieve that, belief has nothing to do with it. It's interesting that term even enters in, like a religion or something. It's it's a matter of following evidence and reaching a judicious conclusion, if you can, as to what's actually going on. The last of the Houdini seances, there is every reason to believe that the Houdini code, the famous code that he left to his wife, was broken by an important medium of that time. And then because the churches of that period were, the Protestant churches especially, were so anti, you'll still see a lot of that on the internet. If you look up some subject like ghosts or whatever, you'll find more entries on what Jesus had to say about fractured ideas about how all parapsychology is the work of the devil, and even an interest in it is punished. Well, Mrs. Houdini, Mrs. Weiss, actually, had an enormous amount of pressure put on her to say that it was that the medium had not cracked the actual code, and that Houdini was indeed dead and buried, and no one can get through from the far side, which I think is ridiculous, since there are mediumship is not one of my stronger things, although this is the time of year to do it if you're going to do it. But that is, it's not on my high on my list of authentic areas, because there are a lot of fakes as well as real things.
Well, you know, I probably know more about the history of spiritualism than anybody else that you're going to run into. And, you know, they always say, well, the seances were taking place in the dark room and blah, blah, blah. But that's not true. Mm-hmm. Most of them, a lot of them did have a light source. And the phenomena was witnessed by dozens of people. In fact, I just wrote a book that we just published called Dark Seance, which is the history of the Davenport brothers. Now, they were either the biggest frauds or the greatest mediums that ever lived. They would put these two brothers all bound up into what they call the spirit cabinet, lock the door, and all kinds of manifestations would come out of the top of the cabinet. Musical instruments would float around the room, tambourines and small drums and clarinets and so forth. Disembodied voices would be heard, and they would open the doors up in the middle of the so-called seance, and they would still be tied up, and there was nobody else in the cabinet. It's a spirit cabinet. It's a wonderful story, and it can't be explained. And I've investigated, you know, of course, it's 200 years ago, but, you know, I've read all the literature on the subject. We've published a couple of books with material from Conan Doyle in it, who, of course, was the author of Sherlock Holmes. Now, he believed perhaps it a little bit too much, but there is a lot to be said for the spiritualist movement, and you're right, a lot of them were hoaxes. There's no doubt about it. You can look at some of the spirit photographs that show the ectoplasm, which was coming out of the medium's ears and nose, and God knows other places.
Yeah, other places. Yeah.
Yeah. But it's a remarkable, you know, history. And there's many similarities between spiritualism and the UFO phenomena, in fact. And I've written about this. And most people don't want to hear it, actually, in the UFO field, because they're still stuck into little green men from Mars and the UFO slides of mummies that are being passed off as aliens in regard to the Roswell case, you know. And, you know, I don't know as if they're trying to hoax people, They're trying to be, maybe they're trying to be sincere, but you know, you got to look into this, and you got a little, you've got to know a little bit of, about history. You got to know a little bit about archaeology. You just can't jump to the first conclusion, because this, the UFO phenomenon, the psychic phenomenon, the ghostly pitter patter of spirits and goblins and things that go, God knows, bump in the night, and far worse than that. There's a lot. There is a lot to be said for it. Now, not every case is legitimate, but we've had on one of our experts on the paranormal and on poltergeists is Paul Eno, and he's investigated quite a number of poltergeist cases, including the Bell Witch. And, you know, he doesn't necessarily go along with the idea that these are spirits of the dead. He sees these more as parasitic phenomena. So, you know, we have spent the last half century of our lives and investigating this, and we will probably do this for many more years to come. But, you know, we've got a few minutes left, Alan. I don't know as if we – I wanted to hear about the floating coffins. Can you do that in 3 minutes?
I don't know if I can or not.
No.
On the island of Barbados, which I spent a considerable amount of time on, and that's like halfway to Africa. I mean, it's in the Caribbean, but one side of the island is very, very calm Caribbean waters, and the other side is roaring Atlantic breakers. It's and the sun sets at like 5 o'clock, what you would consider Eastern time. I think that's called Atlantic time because it's mid-Atlantic. There was a family that, the Chase family, very prominent on the island, a number of governors of the island in the colonial days. Had a vault. It was another place, coincidentally, called Christ Church. In the churchyard there, they had a vaulted mausoleum. And they, because of the somewhat damp climate there, although New Orleans has above ground burials as well because of a much swampier climate, they used heavy lead coffins, and they would seal the tomb up between burials, and when someone in the family passed on, they would put them in one of those lead coffins and put them along the walls of the tomb. And what happened was, after the third or fourth burial, every time they opened it up, these enormously heavy coffins had been completely moved around. Now, this island is not on a earthquake zone, and there were no earthquakes to be discerned, and they had no idea what happened. So I went and investigated it myself in person, almost got bitten by a snake. I might have become the only dead person in there now, because they eventually moved all of the coffins to an undisclosed location, because every time they opened it and had it carefully sealed, it would be in total disarray, and the coffins would be open and thrown around as if they were light as balsa wood. And I couldn't find any way anyone could have gotten in there and gotten out of there, and it would have taken several strong men to do that much moving around. And they would have had to have left no sign that they were there at all. And there just simply was no explanation except the one somebody had scrawled in chalk on the outside of the Chase vault, which is, it said in that Caribbean style of English, "Ghost here, man."
you be gone. And unfortunately, we be gone in just a minute or so. But do I hear the thunder in the background? There go the coffins. Alan, what are you working on? How do our listeners get in touch with you?
Well, what I have taken to telling people is, since I've been on the internet since it was before it was the internet, is Google my name. It's spelled AllenGreenfield. I am working on a new book project to be disclosed, but Angel Spells is still out there and is a powerful book and available through Amazon still, is it not, Tim?
It always is. And also, and you're working on a project, A True History of Wicca?
No, that's out there. In fact, it's an illegal. I'm flattered. Somebody stole my my essay, the True History of Witchcraft, and made it into a. There's the music. Well, read the complete write-up of Memphis, and you'll be able to cross the world.
Well, Alan, you are a wonderful spokesperson for the.
I'm melting. What a world.
Well, happy Halloween to one and all. And remember, I will be coming with my bag, and I expect it to be loaded up with candy and coin. And thank you all, and tune in next week. And where's my umbrella?